I am now going to talk on inflammation in regard to atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, how to prevent, how to minimize inflammation in relation to atherosclerosis. As previously, we used to think that the atherosclerosis is just passive accumulation of lipid in the vessel wall, but now it is well known that it's an inflammatory disease, not just passive deposition of lipid. This is atherosclerosis is a multifactorial, multi-step disease involving chronic inflammation in every steps. Though we have some drugs like statins, ACE inhibitors and platelets, yet we cannot prevent fully the development and progression of the atherosclerosis. In regard to prevent and to reduce the progression and the morbidity and mortality in regard to atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, I am going to talk on a new anti-inflammatory drugs, inflammation, novel drug target in cardiovascular disease. This cardiovascular disease is the leading cause of death globally as well as in our Indian population. Globally, it accounts for 31% of mortality, and Indian population it accounts for 28% mortality. 12 to 60% of coronary artery disease patients are young, they are less than 40 years of age. What are the risk factors? The risk factors are your diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, hemostatic and thrombotics, behavioral, demography, and genetic. These are the risk factors. Then, previously it was known that those who are having more risk factors, they will suffer more, but yet it is now there is a paradox. We see that if there is one risk factor, so the chance of developing cardiovascular disease is 43%, and those who are not having any risk factors, no identifiable risk factor, they are 19% of them are suffering from cardiovascular disease. 60% of those who develop coronary events have only one or even none of the traditional risk factors. More than half have either normal or mildly increased lipid values. This is the surrogate marker of inflammation, the hsCRP. We have CRP, which is a marker of inflammation, and serum amyloid A protein. Because hsCRP is less costly and it is standardized worldwide, that's why hsCRP is more important in regard to mark the inflammation. It's a marker of inflammation. Then if CRP level is high, there is relative risk of developing cardiovascular disease high. Then if LDL-C is normal, even near normal, if hsCRP is high, then development of cardiovascular events are more. So hsCRP is an important biomarker of inflammation. Then these are the recommendations from CDC and American Heart Association regarding measurement of CRP. In 2003, measurement of hsCRP, that is the high sensitive CRP, may help direct further evaluation and therapy in primary prevention of CVD. The entire adult population should not be screened for hsCRP for the purpose of cardiovascular risk assessment. Now in 2010, American College Cardiology Foundation and AHA, American Heart Association guidelines for the assessment of cardiovascular risk in asymptomatic results. They have recommended major CRP in apparently healthy elderly equal to 85 cardiovascular risk. Then in 2013, the SEC and American Heart Association guideline on treatments of blood cholesterol to reduce atherosclerotic cardiovascular risk in adults. They have recommended use of hsCRP for stratifying the high risk patients for atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. Now the process of pathogenesis, the process of your atherometasma. It is well known the larger medium sized elastic and muscular arteries are mostly involved. They are mostly involved in the site of bifurcation, in the site of turbulence, where there is an endothelial dysfunction. Previously we used to think that there is just epithelial detonation and there is an inflammatory cell accumulation. But it is not the denudation, it is the endothelial dysfunction. When there is endothelial dysfunction, there is recruitment of monocyte, and due to the inflammation, the monocyte gets into the vessel, gets into the cell, into the media, where gets into the cell and in the arterial wall, then the LDL, when there is overloaded extracellular overload of lipids, then there is a cell increase in cellular permeability, then LDL gets inside the media. Then this is the culprit, is the not the LDL, it is the LDL oxidized LDL. The oxidized LDL along with the monocyte, they transform the monocyte into the macrophage, and there is the initiation of the deleterious pathway of atherosclerosis, that is the activation of nuclear factor kappa B pathway and the kininurine pathway. The kininurine pathway is a good pathway for prevention of and this atherosclerosis, but this NFKB pathway is there, have a deleterious effect. Once they transform into the macrophage, the macrophage transform into the foam cells, there will be the release of inflammatory mediators. But mostly the important mediator is interleukin 6. The other mediators are tumors, necrosis factor, interleukin 1, CRP, CD40, and so on. Then this vicious cycle goes on. Then there is a release of additional molecules, monocytes are adhered to the vessel wall, that gets inside the media, and there is a process of atherosclerosis starts. The dendritic pathway, the dendritic cells has a good effect. It acts through the kininurine pathway. The kininurine pathway acts on the your tryptophan. Then in our and we have the arm of engineer to reduce the inflammation. We have anti-inflammatory drugs like statin. We have anti-platelet aspirin. We have thiazolidine diones. Yet we cannot prevent. We cannot prevent fully. We can prevent only a subsections who goes into the cardiovascular disease. To prevent further and to reduce the atheromatous plaque, we have this kynurenine pathway where the three-hydroxyanionic acid acts. Now regarding the deleterious pathway, that is the nuclear factor of Kappa-B pathway, there is an inflammatory stimuli. When there is an inflammatory stimuli, there is the activation of IKKB, which causes activation of the nuclear factor Kappa-B, which then translocates into the nucleus, and there will be release of inflammatory mediators like TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, then hsCRP and so on. Then in the cytoplasm there will be adhesion molecules for the adherence of the monocyte, then transformation into the macrophage and form cells. Here, this is the role of curcumin comes, the curcumin of the from Germany. Previous speaker also said regarding the anti-inflammatory effect in regard to arthritis. The curcumin acts in every steps. It prevents activation of nuclear factor Kappa-B. It prevents the translocation of nuclear factor Kappa-B into the nucleus. It prevents the release of inflammatory mediators, the final step. It reduces the inflammations. Then curcumin, the anti-inflammatory role in CVD, it decreases C-reactive protein and MELAN-LDI. It decreases MI associated with CABG. It significantly reduces the serum cholesterol. It prevents progression of diabetic nephropathy by eating proteinuria. Then acting on tumor TGF beta, iodate in diabetic nephropathy. It decreases fasting blood sugar level. Then HbA1c and insulin resistance index. This was this role of curcumin is the was done in various papers. I am quoting from various papers. In the bottom it is written the your from where it was quoted, the study, the American journals. Then the protective pathway, the previously it was nuclear factor Kappa-B pathway, the deleterious pathway for the inflammation and formation of atheromatous plaque. Now the kynurenine pathway. Dendritic cells release indolemide 2,3-deoxygenase. It acts on the tryptophan, transformed into kynurenine, then further it subdivided into anthranic acid and 3-hydroxyanthranine, then it goes into 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid. This is the major target. The 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid, which is important in regard to anti-inflammation. It has anti-atherosclerotic effect. It reduces LDL. 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid, 3-hydroxy intermediate metabolite of tryptophan when metabolized through kynurenine pathway. In macrophages, 3-hydroxyanthranilic acid can inhibit the activation of nuclear factor Kappa-B and activity of inducible nitric oxide synthase. It inhibit interleukin 2, interleukin 7, interleukin 15 stimulation. 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid reduces the uptake of oxidized LDL, the culprit in the development of atherosclerosis by macrophage and prevent formation of foam cells. Here the figure shows how 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid modify the lipid metabolism. It inhibits T1 necrosis factor alpha in macrophage. It prevents it, significantly increases liver mRNA and reduces and increases ApoA1, which is important. ApoB is dangerous, ApoA is good for prevention of the for the atheromatous plaque. Then the effect of 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid on plasma lipid, it reduces plasma cholesterol, it reduces plasma triglyceride, it increases HDL, it decreases VLDL. Thus, 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid significantly decreases plasma lipids by 1/3 to 2/3 from the now the effect of 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid on inflammation. It reduces the inflammatory markers like CD4 and it reduces the collagen formation, that is the collagen fibril 1 and 2 in the atheromatous plaque. 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid significantly reduces infiltration of CD4 T cells in atherosclerotic lesion. Then the effect of 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid on atherosclerosis, it reduces the atheromatous plaque. 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid significantly reduces inflammation, and in some cases there is reduction is to the tune of 80%. In summary, 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid is an intermediate metabolite of the urine pathway, acting on the tryptophan metabolism. It has clinically significant benefits. It improves lipid profile by decreasing VLDL, LDL levels and increasing HDL levels. 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid significantly reduces vascular inflammation, as previous studies I have already mentioned in the previous slides. And these are the targets. These are the pipeline, these studies are on the pipeline, these are some are phase 1 to phase 3 trials. How to reduce the inflammation? Acting on your inflammatory mediators, phospholipase inhibitors, leukotrienes. Previously, we tried with antioxidant, like vitamin A, vitamin C, and vitamin E, but we are not successful. But vitamin E has some role in regard to development of the atheromatous plaque. But that's why we have to search for the newer molecules. In newer molecules, we have talked about one molecule, this curcumin. The other one is 3-hydroxyanthocyanic acid. The conclusion is that despite optimum therapy with current drugs, still 1/3 of low-risk individuals with 0 to 1 FRS risk factor have been known to develop atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, and in controlling inflammation, it will be helpful to improve the cardiovascular outcome. We need to go search for a more effective and newer molecules to prevent morbidity and mortality in regard to cardiovascular disease. Thanks for patience.